Hello and welcome to another adventure here on my channel. Today I'm going to be talking about the re-rise of Crocs, because if there has ever been a controversial shoe, this is it. But Crocs are back. If anything, I am late to the party saying that Crocs are back. So today I want to talk a little bit about their history, how and why they have resurged and come back into popularity, and my own personal experience with Crocs. Because if you think that I was going to do this video and not pick me up a pair of Crocs, then hello and welcome to the channel, because this must be your first time here. So let's go ahead and dive right in and start with the history of Crocs, because I spent way too much time yesterday learning about these shoes and I want to share what I found because it's actually fairly interesting. It turns out that Crocs started out as a boating shoe, as they were lightweight, comfortable, easy to keep clean, and would it even be considered water resistant? Like, they react well to water and also they float, so they were the perfect boating shoes.
Three friends, Scott Siemens, George Bodecker, and Lyndon Hansen, came up with the idea while sailing in the Caribbean. Siemens was wearing a slip and odor resistant clog, made by a Canadian company called Foam Creations. Bodecker and Hansen thought they were ugly, but were sold on their functionality. They licensed Foam Creations' foam resin technology, called it Cross Light, and developed the Croc.
So they debuted either in 2001 or 2002. My sources differ, but 2002 was the more popular year between sources. I only found one source that said 2001, but either in 2001 or 2002 at the Fort Lauderdale Boat Show in Florida, and they were an instant hit. They sold out all 200 pairs that were made and brought to the show. And the brand Crocs just grew from there and hit some more mainstream popularity around 2005 to 2007. And I remember this. I was in elementary school during this time. I was in fifth grade. I forget which year exactly, but the year that I was in fifth grade was the year of the Croc. Everyone was wearing them. I had a pair of off-brand Crocs that we got at Walmart for like $5 to $10. They were light blue and I absolutely adored these shoes. I was a huge fan. I was a kid. They were comfortable. They were lightweight and they matched my school uniform. Like, I went to a public elementary school that still had school uniforms for some reason, but they worked with my school uniform. I was allowed to wear them and I adored them. I even have a specific memory of being on the kickball field. We were playing kickball, it was fifth grade, and my teacher would always say, "Oh, look out, we got some Crocs on the field, the crocodiles are on the field," whenever I would step up to kick the ball, and I just loved that. I thought it was so fun. So I loved my Crocs, but since they were off-brand Crocs, and they are a pretty lightweight, kind of cheapy material, they didn't last super long. They kind of lasted for, I think, my fifth grade year and maybe the summer, and then they just kind of fell apart because they were a foam shoe and I was a little kid going about my business. And around the time that my off-brand Crocs fell apart, the fad was definitely over because Crocs back then had this sort of boom and fade. They never completely went away, but it very much became not super societally acceptable to just be an adult casually wearing a pair of Crocs out and about. As strong as the rise of the Crocs was, so was equally strong the rise of the Croc haters. People hated this shoe or loved this shoe. Some people were like, "I hate myself for loving this shoe because it's so ugly, but I love it because it's just so comfortable." So around the time that the Croc haters kind of won the cultural battle of, "We don't like this shoe, please don't wear this in public anymore," the company also had a big dip because of the 2008 financial crisis, like a lot of companies had, but also it was kind of this mix of bad timing because not only was there a financial crash, but the original fad was over and Crocs were kind of delegated to the sidelines of, there are specific times and people who are allowed to wear Crocs, mainly kids, but they are not a shoe. They are not a fashion shoe. They're not really something people just wear out and about.
People who love to hate Crocs had cause to celebrate in 2008 when investors were writing the company off as a passing fad. Crocs lost over $185 million that year and cut about 2,000 jobs. The stock plunged to just over $1 a share from a high of about $69 a year earlier.
So that combined seemed to really cause the fall of the Croc brand. But like I said, they never really completely went away. And now it is 2021 and Crocs are back. In my opinion, they are back with a vengeance because I remember people either really liked the shoe because of how comfortable it was, or they really hated the shoe because of how it looked, or a mix of both. But it was kind of this, you either had some or you didn't. It wasn't like a statement item. It was not a fashion piece. It was like either you agree it's super comfortable and you want to wear it, or you don't like it. You didn't have this sort of cult following around Crocs that I found today, especially on things like TikTok, and I found several YouTube videos, people talking about their Crocs and collecting Crocs. That wasn't, at least that I observed, really a thing back during their first rise, their first boom of popularity, the first time they were on trend. It was like you had some, you might have had a couple different colors, but you didn't have people owning 50, 60 pairs of Crocs and showing them off all over social media. I mean, social media wasn't really a thing back then, but you didn't really have this community around hyping up Crocs like we see today. So what caused this? How did Crocs go from a made fun of fad of the past and a children's shoe to kind of a hype beast collector item, fashion item even? And my theory is, from what I found, that it is simply a really, really good marketing campaign. That's what made the difference for Crocs. A good marketing campaign that hit at the right time. So first of all, Crocs listened to their consumers, because even though the fad was over, there were still some people wearing Crocs. A lot of it was for practical reasons, for kids or jobs where you're on your feet a lot, but there were still some people that wore them as like a fashion shoe. So Crocs paid attention to who those people were and why they were wearing the shoes and why they continued to wear them for fashion when you'd kind of get made fun of for wearing Crocs, to be honest. Because for a long time, Crocs have been seen as kind of a trashy shoe to wear if you're an adult. When I first started talking about Crocs and telling my boyfriend, like, hey, Crocs are back, he sent me this picture, this meme. And I feel like this has been the perception of Crocs for a while. Okay for kids, but if you're an adult wearing them, this is tends to be the thing people think of, tends to be the assumption made about you is kind of trashy. And these people seem to continue wearing them as a statement, as a way of saying, I know people don't like this. I know it stands out, and I don't care what your opinion of me is. I'm gonna wear what makes me feel comfortable. It was kind of this subversive fashion statement. It was kind of this way of saying, hey, I don't give a crap what you think about me. I'm gonna do what makes me comfortable and me happy.
When I show up somewhere in Crocs, like, it is very evident that, like, I'm not too concerned with any social hierarchy that's going on. This is how I dress. This is what makes me comfortable, and that's all I care about.
It kind of reminded me of actually a bit from Firefly that was Jane's hat.
Pretty cunning, don't you think?
I think it's the sweetest hat ever.
Man walks down the street in that hat. People know he's not afraid of anything.
Damn straight.
And Crocs capitalized on this. They zoned in, refined their messaging, and capitalized on this item as a shoe of rebellion, as a shoe of self-expression and individuality and going against the norm. Because their first tagline, their first slogan was, get a grip. Because apparently they were referencing the grip the shoe provided and focusing on the functionality of the shoe, mainly when it came to boating. But now their company tagline is, come as you are, which, one, great Nirvana song, but it really plays into this whole individuality, you be you kind of thing. They also heavily capitalized on the gibbets, which are those little charms people put in the holes of their Crocs. I don't have any, but they very much pushed that as an aspect, as a feature of this shoe, is you can customize and personalize it, which is a huge trend. Customization is a huge trend, especially with Gen Z right now. So that combination of their core fashion audience being really big on customization and individuality, and the younger generation being really into customization and individuality, made their product a really good fit for right now, for the current times. But that's not all they did. Because next, after they refined their message, they turned to influencer marketing. Freaking Ariana Grande wore Crocs. Probably the current biggest pop star of our time wore Crocs. and several other celebrities were seen wearing Crocs that they were probably sent for free by the company, because if they're seen wearing Crocs, it gives the company a huge boost. It gives Crocs a cool factor, because that's the thing with our society and celebrities. If celebrities do it, it's seen as cool. They kind of are the trendsetters of our time. It just kind of is how it is. But there's also the social media influencers. And in my research for this video, I found a couple videos from fashion influencers that were sponsored by Crocs, styling Crocs with different outfits.
Thank you to Crocs for sponsoring this video. And I'd like to thank Crocs for sponsoring this video.
They were very similar videos. They were like 5-day work week outfits with Crocs, and they showed the different styles of Crocs, because Crocs don't just have these clogs now, the classic clog. They have so many different variations and styles, and they even have tennis shoes now. So they sent these influencers, I assume the influencers got to pick different Crocs that they would style with different outfits, and they also sent them a lot of the different gibbets for the video, because in each of these videos, the person spent time talking about how they customized their Crocs with these different gibbets. And I think this is a really good example of using influencer marketing, of targeting both the macro influencers with the actual celebrities and targeting the more micro-focused, like, fashion influencer people, fashion tastemakers with the smaller, but, you know, not small, both of the channels I saw doing these videos had a few hundred thousand subscribers, but compared to, like, Ariana Grande, that is still pretty small. But these fashion influencers, fashion tastemakers, and sponsoring them to make content with your product. It's a well-executed marketing campaign for this product, even though it's fairly simple. I feel like any brand can, you know, send their product to some celebrities hoping the celebrities will wear them, and then sponsor some influencers that make something in their product niche, that make content in their product's niche. It's simple, but it's effective. But that's not all they did, because next they took a page out of Supreme's book. They took a page out of these hype beast brands' books with the limited edition drops type of marketing, because Crocs in general are not that scarce. Like, anyone can go and buy a pair of Crocs, and like, I got mine in black or white or any number of colors. But by creating these specific, really hyped collaborations that were very limited, it gave the shoe an air of exclusivity and artificial scarcity that it did not have otherwise. And again, by collaborating with celebrities and some of these high fashion brands, they really brought a lot of attention to this shoe and made it a status symbol in the way it was kind of the exact opposite of before. Like, it was kind of seen as this trashy shoe that no one really wore, and it wasn't a fashion item, it wasn't lusted after, you didn't want to be seen wearing the Crocs. Two, let's make this a statement item. Let's make this something people want to be seen in, and that they hype up, and that they lust after and covet, and is resold for so much more than it originally sold for.
Oh my god, TikTok, I got some Crocs to show you guys. I got them from StockX. 130, 103.
So they did limited edition drops with Balenciaga, Post Malone, and Justin Bieber. And side tangent here, since when is Justin Bieber cool? Like, when did that happen? Last I knew of Justin Bieber, he was like going to jail for drugs or something. He was just known as this asshole who got famous really young and no one really liked him, and then he came out with that terrible song Yummy, and now he's like cool again or fashionable and people wanted his collaboration with Crocs. That's wild to me. But anyway, they did collaborations with these people that sold out super quickly. They were limited edition drops, and they were a Croc that not anyone could just get. Anyone can get this black pair of Crocs. Not anyone could just get that Justin Bieber pair of Crocs, or that Post Malone pair of Crocs, or the Balenciaga pair of Crocs, which creates artificial scarcity around the product. And artificial scarcity is defined as scarcity of items despite the available technology for production or the sufficient capacity for sharing. Basically, they could make as many pairs of these Post Malone Crocs as they wanted to, but they specifically didn't, to keep it scarce and exclusive, and it is just a marketing tactic. But it is a marketing tactic that they have executed well, especially with how hype beast culture and flexing culture is on social media. Having these specific pair of Crocs is a flex when having a normal pair is not, or having 60 pairs of Crocs is a flex when having two pairs is not. They created this artificial scarcity and this hype around their product through making it cool with influencers and the tastemakers of our generation and these limited edition, artificially scarce hype products. And finally, it was just good timing for them. It was just good timing for this brand, because mostly the generation who is deciding what is cool right now is Gen Z. It's always the teenagers, the 20-somethings, the younger generation dictates what is cool. And the younger generation, Gen Z and Zillennials, kind of my age range, a little bit higher and a little bit lower, we didn't have Crocs as adults. We had them as kids. And as you can tell from the beginning of this video, a lot of us remember Crocs very fondly. I personally remembered Crocs very fondly, and when I heard they were back, I was like, oh my gosh, I have to get a pair because I loved those shoes. So there's that nostalgia factor, specifically in the generation that kind of decides right now what is cool. And again, what's cool with Gen Z right now is individuality and customization, which these shoes do provide. And like every generation likes to rebel against their parents and likes to say, hey, what you didn't like, we like. So it doesn't surprise me that a shoe that was very much disliked by the older generation would come back into trend, especially with the way that this brand has been really smart about marketing it to the right generation. Because they could have tried to market it as this work shoe that's super comfortable and more of a functional piece, and reminded the Gen Xers that, hey, you liked these before because they were comfortable, maybe you could like them again, but they didn't do that. They went in an opposite direction and it really worked for their brand and their company. And now these things are freaking huge again, and I'd say even bigger than they were before, because you have people flexing these huge collections, which is just not a thing that happened on the first rise of Crocs. So the right time, the customization of the product, and the meaning of the product, with it being a kind of middle finger to the people who don't like them, who judge you, who bully you for liking the shoe because they find it ugly, that's what made Crocs rise. They took their weaknesses and made them into strengths, and they took what was already strong about the product and focused on it and marketed those aspects of it.
Girl, don't do it. It's not
already did it. Already did it.
Because I gotta say, like, this is a good quality product. I forgot that I only had the, like, knockoff Crocs before, but the real Crocs, because these are real Croc brand Crocs, you can see here, they are a good product. They are sturdier than I remember. I feel like these are gonna last longer than my original ones did. They are super, super comfortable, and they are really easy to clean and wash and keep nice, because a couple days before I filmed this video, I actually wore these all day at an amusement park and they got a little bit dirty. So I went ahead and washed them just to see, you know, is it really as easy as people say to keep these clean and nice? And it was. So yesterday I went to the local theme park and I wore my Crocs all day, which they were fantastic for that, for walking all around the theme park and being comfortable. They were really nice, but I feel like they got just a little bit dirty and I want them to look clean and fresh and nice for when I film this video. So I'm gonna go ahead and test how easy they are to clean up, to wash, and just wash them in my kitchen sink and see how it goes. Here are the Crocs in the kitchen sink. Yeah, I'm just gonna try to rinse them off real good. It's weird washing your shoes in the kitchen sink, I will say. It is kind of weird, but that is one of the appeals of these shoes, is they are easy to keep clean and nice because you can just wash them off real quick. All right, here they are on their paper towels, and now I'm just going to set them outside for a little while to dry, and hopefully that works well. I wipe them off a little bit with the paper towel, but mostly I'm just putting them in the sun right here and hoping that works, and I'll be back in, I don't know, half an hour-ish. We'll see. Maybe I should leave them kind of like this so they can dry better, and yeah, pretty easy, I'd say. All right, it's been about an hour now, and they seem mostly dry. A little bit on the bottom is still damp, but overall, I think they look good. It was really easy to clean, and they are looking pretty nice again. So I'd say the claim about being easy to clean and keep nice checks out. Personally, here's my personal take on Crocs. I have never understood the hatred of Crocs because I don't find them ugly. Like, I genuinely don't find the shoe ugly. It's not like super cute. It's not like I'm like, oh, high fashion, love it. It's what I'm gonna wear when I just want to look absolutely phenomenal fashion peak. Like, that's not how I feel about this shoe. But I feel like it's just, it's a very shoe. Like, this is the most shoe a shoe can be. I feel like no matter what time period or era or culture, if you handed someone this, they'd be like, yeah, that's a shoe. I don't know if that explanation makes sense to other people, but it works in my head, so please let me know if it like makes sense to you. But to me, it's just a very well designed shoe. It's not particularly pretty, but it's not particularly ugly either, and I've been enjoying wearing these. I think they're super comfortable. They're super easy to slip on and off. Like, all of the benefits people talk about, they do have. And since I'm not someone who was like, oh my gosh, it's so ugly, I was kind of hyped they were back. Like, even if I wasn't making this video, I still would have got a pair of Crocs because I've been kind of waiting for the resurgence of Crocs because I remembered them and I remembered how much I loved them. But as someone who got pretty bullied in middle school, I'm still a little bit sensitive to wearing things that I'm like, yeah, I had a really good high chance I could get bullied for wearing that, which is why I didn't just like buy some before they were in style. But I'm happy they're in style again, and I think this time, since I do genuinely just like the Crocs, I'm probably just gonna keep a pair around for the rest of my life as long as these last, and then I might pick up another pair. I don't know, I'm considering getting them in white, and I've considered getting some gibbets. My problem with the gibbets is they're too damn expensive. Like, it is $5 per gibbet, or like $15 to $16 for a pack, and that is just more than I am willing to spend on a little charm that goes on my shoes sometime. And since I do like the bear croc, I don't know if it's worth it to me. Like, I would pay $1 per gibbet. I might even pay $2 per gibbet, maybe $2.50, but $5 is just too much for what it is. But it does play into that like hype beast, exclusivity, luxury product type of vibe I feel like the brand is going for. But it's just not what I'm willing to spend that money on, because I don't want just like one or two gibbets. I would want to get a handful, five or six, and that's $25 to $30 plus shipping if I bought them off their website. Like, no. And since I've yet to see a pack where I'm like, yes, I want literally every single gibbet that is in that pack, it hasn't been worth it to me to pay the $15 or $16 for the pack, because I'm really only buying it for two or three, which again is $5 a gibbet. So just out of curiosity, just for fun, I put all the gibbets I would want in a cart on crocs.com just to see, and the total is $48.93. Like, no, that is so ridiculous. That is more than I paid for the shoes themselves. Like, that is more than I paid for the shoes themselves on little decorative things. Like, no. So overall, I am very impressed with this brand's marketing strategy, and I think it worked probably better than they even were expecting, just because of the natural trends, the things they had nothing to do with that just happened to be in trend for this generation, the customization, the individuality, and the nostalgia factor. I think all of that played in their favor, but I've been really enjoying my Crocs. I think they're nice. I think they're comfortable. I do wear them both with and without socks without a problem. I do tend to put them in what is now known as sport mode, which is with the thingy, the handle thing back instead of up front. But Sometimes I've worn them up front, sometimes I've worn them in the back. I like them. I like them. I think they're good quality, and I am glad I have added them into my life, even if my boyfriend genuinely hates them. He makes fun of me all the time for these shoes.
Shoes my BF wants me to wear.
Brought out the pink limp. But I don't care. I like them, and they actually look fairly cute with several of my summer outfits, so I'm happy with these. I am glad they're back in style, and I hope this video has helped you answer the question of why the heck are probably the most hated shoes of all time back in style now with the youths, with the Gen Zs, with the Zillennials like me, because I don't know if I'm Gen Z or Millennial, so Zillennial is a good label. So I hope this video has been informative and fun. Please let me know your opinion of Crocs down in the comments. Do you love them? Do you hate them? Do you think they're just the ugliest thing you've ever seen? Or are you like me and don't actually think they're that ugly? I would love to know your thoughts. Thank you so, so much for watching, and I will see you all next time. A lot of times when I'm film, I genuinely am like wearing normal pants too, but this was one of those videos and those times that I was just like, I am too lazy, so I got ready from here up, and then I am still wearing my Star Wars boxers, because boxers are the freaking best.